Good morning. Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living, Pleasant Valley in Camarillo, California. I'm Reverend Pam Geagan, and it is my joy to be with you today.
Good Sunday, everybody. I'm Reverend Lynn Chaplinoe from the Center for Spiritual Living, Pleasant Valley. And if you would like to, this would be a good time for you to start your watch party so that we can share the word today. This is a very, very important session that we have today. We have Reverend Betty Ann Brennan, Reverend Pam Geagan, who is our spiritual leader, Buzz Noe, and Daniel Berkman is our musical inspiration today. And also our very special guest is Reverend Dr. Sue Rubin. Our vision is awakening humanity to its spiritual magnificence. And the way that we do that is teaching and demonstrating spiritual principles for living an abundant and fulfilling life in a welcoming and compassionate community. And we have our flames of faith. We believe there is one source and many paths leading to that source. We honor all faiths, Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Judaism, Sufism, and all others that step forward in love. There is that one fine thread that connects all religions in the world, and that thread is love. We come from love, we are love, and we honor our oneness within us all. And with that, here is Reverend Betty Ann Brennan with our quote for the day.
Think on these words today, let them be yours. I let go of resistance and allow the perfect plan for my life to unfold under grace in a wonderful way. And to solidify that idea, join me now in an opening treatment. I am at one with the infinite power of the universe. That allness that creates for us and recreates in unknown ways. And I know what is being said and what is being shown today is uplifting. That's the importance. Right now, that infinite consciousness is preparing something perfect for each one of us. This is a meaningful experience as we move through this blessed day. We let go and we begin to allow that deeper understanding, that greater selfhood to come forward in our lives every moment. Not only for us to know, but it's so pure, it's seen by all. I do give thanks that we are here and that we have this understanding and that we can go deeper and deeper into that understanding. And I know that as I turn these words over to that infinite unity, that infinite power, we receive the greatest blessing of ever. And then we close with, and so it is.
So it is.
And now it is my honor to show you a film clip. Thank you, Betty Ann, so much. And this is a film clip for our uplifting moments in an untethered world. And it's Steve Harvey and Oprah Winfrey. And it is about stop telling your dreams to small-minded people. Stop telling your big dreams to small-minded people as we go into our courageous conversations morning.
wanted to ask you, how do you overcome the fears and doubts?
I mean, look, the fears and doubts are a part of it. Can I be honest with you? Oh. Everything I've ever done started with a fear. My walking out on stage, that starts with the fear. When Oprah came and got me for this life class, I said, boy, this is like a stand-up appearance for me. I'm back there sweating. I don't want to talk to nobody. I have to overcome fear all the time. When I wrote my book, I was afraid. When they told me we wanted you to be a game show host, I'd never done that. I was afraid. When they said, why don't you do a talk show? I was afraid. I have to overcome fear all the time. But the best way for me to overcome fear is the dream has to be bigger than the fear. That's the only way you turn around and run at it. I just want something so great. I aim for stuff so big that the dream is bigger than the fear. Look at it like this, man. If you don't ever go for this, would it be better for you to face the fear or just deal with the fact that you just never gave it a shot?
Oh, face it, definitely.
See, that's what the dream. And I saw you with your tie on. I know that makeup mirror. That's backstage somewhere in a dressing room. Somebody's hiring guys like you. There's no such thing as too old. I'm 57. If I went back out there, I'd get hired tomorrow as a stand-up. If you find it, there's a marketplace for you. Now, look, you got to
start where you are, right?
Just
start where you are.
You don't worry, man. Where you at? Now, don't stop paying the house note and stuff.
Okay, so let's go through it. You have to know your gift. Do you think you're gifted at this?
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Okay.
And then you have to be clear about your vision.
Absolutely.
Okay, and then surround yourself with other dreamers. Let's talk about that.
You know, if you don't surround yourself with other dreamers, here's what I know. If 9 of your friends are broke, you're going to be the 10th one. That's it. If 7 of your friends smoke, you're going to be number 8. If you stay with that circle of friends, you've got to surround yourself with like-minded people. See, stop telling your big dreams to small-minded people. Take yourself. Look, you're talking to me. You're 52, I'm 57. I'm a stand-up comedian, been one for 30 years. It's a natural thing for me. I would talk to people who are in the business, talk to people who are doing it. Don't let your age define you. Jack Benny, Jonathan Winters, Red Skelton.
George Burns. At 90, I took up country music. I figured, why not? I'm older than most countries.
That was pretty good right there, see? See, my mouth, I've never been able to do impressions. You know, I can't do that. So I see a guy like you, the golf tournaments, the corporate gigs that's available, clean corporate gigs like that. But surround yourself with people who are like-minded so you can quit getting the negative stuff that's been stopping you anyway.
And I'm back again to introduce you to one of my favorite sections of this program, and it's What's the Buzz with our wonderful Buzz Noe. Take it, Buzz.
Thank you, Reverend Penn, and good morning, everyone. And it is the middle of August, and it's pretty darn hot. But let's stay focused on the perfection we've got, which will reveal to us some ways to stay cool, be it air conditioning, fans, the ocean, or the pool. A positive attitude provides the wellness you seek. And here's the announcements for this week. Daily meditations are at 9 a.m. on Facebook Live with Reverend Pam Geagan inspiring us to thrive. The Four Agreements will continue this week, providing that spiritual connection you seek. And Monday night sessions are not online. Writers Group meets in person from 7 to 9. Come and discover why writing is an art as we gather live, but at 6 feet apart. A reminder that our center is always here for you, so please just let us know what we can do. The prayers and treatment that we provide will give you the help that you need to thrive. You can call or leave a request on the phone or send us an email from wherever you roam. And until it is safe to re-enter, please donate to our center. Your donations will keep our center alive, so we'll be here to help you thrive. And here are two charities that will appreciate your gift as they reach out to those who need a lift. The Ventura County Rescue Mission and the Ventura County Food Share are there to show that you're one who cares. Finally, a reminder that it's hot out now, but comfort is in reach. All it takes is a trip to the beach. And that's it for the announcements. Thanks for listening. And now it is my pleasure to introduce to you our practitioner of the day, who happens to be me. So once again, I want to thank you for being here. Today's lesson will be soon following as Reverend Pam and Dr. Sue discuss today's theme of courageous conversations. Now, I appreciate that or anticipate that they will probably advise us to follow the words of Brené Brown, which is posted on the Constant Contact page. And she reminds us that we must speak up, because the day you don't speak up for the things that matter to you is the day that your freedom truly ends. So I'm pretty sure that they'll also remind us that when you do speak up and speak out, allow the motivation for what you're saying come from love, compassion, joy, and unity. That way it will be something sending a positive message and continuing a positive flow. Our founder, Dr. Ornish Holmes, who I always like to reference, says it this way: just what is meant by your word? It means your conscious intention, your conscious direction, your conscious faith and acceptance that because of what you are doing, the power of spirit will flow through your word in the direction that you give it. And that will help us move forward. And it syncs up nicely with the CSL theme for today, which happens to be colorful or colorblind. And it advises us to recognize the unity of all life, but also appreciate the uniqueness of everything that exists in nature, in animals, and yes, in our as humans as well. We are all individually unique. And it's a wonderful message that even as we celebrate the unity of all life that we acknowledge because of the oneness that is God, we should also recognize that God represents the infinity of energy and intelligence in the universe. And since each one of us is an individual manifestation of that infinite nature of God, this fact alone makes each of us a unique and totally unmatched representation of our individual spiritual perfection and magnificence. We are all one, but we are each individuals within that one. And there's some other quotes that I'd like to reference that recognize the same aspect of our human condition. As we grow as unique persons, we learn to respect the uniqueness of others. And that's from Robert H. Schuller. And this from a show business personality who's also very spiritually minded, Bethany Frankel, who says, when you embrace your difference, your DNA, your look, your heritage, your religion, or your unusual name, that's when you start to shine. Acknowledging our individuality will get us to move forward positively. And there's a short quote from Margaret Mead, which I've referenced before, who sums up the entire situation for this. Always remember that you are absolutely unique, just like everyone else. And it says it all right there. And so when we recognize and approach those differences from the perspective, again, of love, compassion, joy, and unity, then we appreciate and celebrate our individual uniqueness while at the same time knowing we are all one with God. And on these notes, I will go into a treatment. As I say these words in the first person, please do make them your own. For I do know that right here and right now, in this singular moment of time and space, as the continuing infinite evolution of time and space continues within me and around me, that there is one source, one power, we call it one God, that is the manifestation of all that is around us and within us. And I know that I am here now in this moment and connected through that oneness with God and with all that is, but individually representing that unity, individually representing that perfection that is God as me to all of those around me. And I know that as I go forward and speak my word, bring forth my feelings, my knowledge, my embracing of the oneness, in a way that is positive, motivated by joy and unity and compassion and love, that this will continue to spread that positive message to all of those around me, to everything and everyone that I come into contact with, both individually in person and as we are doing these days online, bringing forth that message that in our uniqueness, we are providing the unity that is God. And I know that as I continue forth with this message, speaking it as I can, wherever I can, it will continue to allow my fold to my life to unfold perfectly and allow me to realize and recognize the perfection that is mine and shared within myself with everyone and everything around me. And I do thank God for the awareness of my uniqueness and yet my continuing unity with all that is, and know that as I continue to bring this forth, everything will be as it is supposed to be, and conducting things the way they are supposed to be conducted. I thank God for this recognition, this realization, and I do release these words into that unique oneness that is God, that infinite awareness, perfection, and spirit that is God, to take care of the details, while I know and rest in confidence that my life will continue to be exactly as it needs to be for my life to unfold the way it should. And I thank God for this and close by saying in unison, and so it is. And so it is that I am finished as a practitioner. And it is my pleasure to introduce my son, Lynn's son, for our musical inspiration for the day. Here he is, Mr. Daniel Berkman.
Thank you so much, Buzz. Wonderful treatment. My name is Daniel Berkman, and I'm a multi-instrumentalist. And today I'm going to play a whole array of instruments that I have that I loop together. So I'm sort of a on-the-spot composer, if you will. I was asked to play a song this morning called Peace, Love, and Unity, which was written for the Kora, which I will play. And it was written by one of my Kora teachers, Pa Bobo. This is called Peace, Love, and Unity.
Peace, love, and unity.
Danny, thank you so much. That it's like a whole spiritual energetic experience, and it is. Talk about unique. You are that unique reflection of the divine in such a great way, and your music is raising the vibration of the planet. I know right now I just want to be in the heaven world after that. Thank you so much, honey, and we'll see you after Sue and I are together here. So it is now, as I come back into reality, it is a third dimensional reality. It is my honor to introduce our wonderful guest, my teacher, my mentor, my dearest friend of the heart, this courageous woman, Reverend Dr. Sue Rubin, for our talk, which is Courageous Conversations. And thank you so much, Dr. Sue, for being with us. You always tease me. Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, take it away, Reverend Pam. Great to be with you.
Always, always great to be with you. And I want to start in this moment of courageous communications is with the Center for Spiritual Living, that they all came together for this statement of inclusion and affirmation. So I just want to share that with everybody. And it's, we, the Centers for Spiritual Living, are a community that celebrates diversity, fosters inclusions, champions inner work, and creates space for brave, vulnerable conversations. What we're going to have today, and then I'll just, it's not very much longer. We are a community that honors the unique emanation of God that each person embodies, advocates for human rights and dignity for all. We are a community that blesses each other, sees holiness in all life, remains learners and listeners so that we can grow together, and understands that oneness is not sameness. And we, the Centers for Spiritual Living, know that the beloved community is revealed when we love each other. And I'm going to just say one other thing, and the word courage comes from the Latin, and it is the root word, which means courage is a heart word. For it is one of the earliest forms of that word, meant to speak one's mind by telling one's heart. And so it is not just about doing brave things in the physicality of the world, but by being, speaking your truth and speaking truth to power. And I just want to know, after that long soliloquy again, please join me.
So I was thinking, as I heard those wonderful words, how many words have been offered by so many organizations, governments, we the people. Take it into the words most recently that we heard so many of from John Lewis. Everybody who proclaims that equality and justice for all and honors the individuality of all, and yet seen in the personalized expression that each one of us are going through, it's like, well, that's beautiful, that's wonderful. What does that have to do with me today? How can I find a way out of what I discovered? It's difficult for me to honor diversity when I see the lashing out of people that seem to resent and resist the individuality, whichever side we seem to appear to be on, whether politically or economically, or down to the COVID, wear a mask, don't wear a mask. We seem, although it created it out of that same one universal essence, why do we have such difficulty in honoring the diversity and the differences that have been handed down by the word of God that's been referred to, which is the word we speak always, and always from the level of our own awareness. Am I really divine? And so, as you alluded to, Reverend Pam, courage comes from decor, the heart, and communication, conversations, all trace themselves back to communing, to that oneness with another, to be together. So if we're together in the way of the heart, that demands of us something beyond what our linear and limbic emotional systems call us to. Those are the ones that call us to recognize differences rather than to trace ourselves back to that kindness and that generosity of the heart, that is of the courage to speak of our oneness rather than to tear each other apart out of our differences of simply opinion. So that's why spiritual practices, I think, are more important today than ever before. The meditating, the faith tradition, whichever it is for you, in science of mind, it's a wonderful technique of simply spiritually treating our mind to move from and yet include the intellect, but to bring it into the place of intuitive all-knowingness. So practice, practice, practice.
Yes, and what I know for sure is that as you are speaking in all of this, I want to say that, what did Ernest Holmes say right here? He said, I will not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justly now, love mercy now, walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. And that's actually, that's from the Talmud. That's not from Ernest Holmes. And what in these times where there are divisive emanations constantly coming from everywhere around us in every subject, including our history, which is now being, that light is being shown on everything in our history, to our beingness, to everything. I go back to that place of knowingness that there is this oneness that does connect us, and it is that courage of the heart. What is difficult as ministers, and I want you to address this, is speaking out. Where is the fine line from speaking of the courage of the heart and also speaking to the courage of being in the oneness when it comes to political challenges right now for us in the world?
So years ago, when I first came into then very clearly recognized as the Organization of Religious Science International, there was no way that we would ever discuss politics. There was no way we would ever involve ourselves in anything that clearly reflects a difference of opinion. People have always held varying views on what they believe or who they prefer politically and in every other way. And so it was always that absolute, the unconditioned, the undifferentiated, come to the one. The one will reveal how to deal with the many facets, obviously, of our individuality and personality. So fast forward. Now, of course, in recent times, the hesitancy at first of some of those like myself who have been in this teaching a very long time, who still resisted the conversation, having the courageous conversation to say, if we can't take politics into spirituality, if we can't take money, economics, into spirituality, and if we can't take disease into spirituality, what are we doing? We're just sitting, contemplating our belly buttons and remaining on a mountaintop when life all around us is in a chaotic state. It always is at some point or another, to a lesser or greater degree. So now, of course, the organization, which has subsequently evolved as a unified group, bringing two facets of science and mind together, known as the Centers for Spiritual Living, now are focusing on unity within diversity and having the conversation. And still what we see within a quote-unquote spiritual organization is the differing opinions, where it's still no. Politics is still not what I am going to offer at my podium when I'm speaking, because I'm hesitant that my opinion will seep into the conversation. And I'm not here, as the statement has been made, in a world that's round, what's the point in taking sides? So I'm not going to let my own preferences override the principle. I'm going to speak of oneness, while at the same time, obviously, addressing injustice and using my own undeveloped consciousness to see more about the white privilege, if you will, and how this applies to me. And I had truly a classic example of that. The other night, just in flipping around on YouTube, I came upon a classical concert. And the concert consisted, of course, of the multifaceted instruments. And on this classical violin, there were three women. They were all black. And one was heavy black, another was slim black, another had the wild and wonderful hair black. And I looked and I blinked and I realized that my perception, my paradigm, had only up to that point entertained black musicians as jazz artists, as rappers, as hip hop artists. I had never seen or experienced a classical violinist in the form of my sister, a black woman, and now three of them. And what did that do for me? It brought me to this cocoon that I had been born and raised in, which always brought me to a safe place within my own tribe, whether it was being white, whether it was being Jewish, whether it was being involved in a spiritual community. It's the danger of something becoming insulated out of a sense of purity. And certainly what we're teaching is so pure and so beautiful at its core. But until it's put into practical application through politics, through Black Lives Matter, through every color, shape, and form matters, sexual preferences. And yet everything that's happening is saying, wake up, people. You've enjoyed pretty much your own cocoon up to this point. That day is long since gone. What are you going to do about it? Beirut, fires. I mean, it's like, you name it. And it's like, okay, what next? Oh, divine universal mind to get our attention. And the last thing we want to do is the first thing we need to be doing, which is a quote from Annie Lamott, which gives the clue. Mm. She's a wonderful poet, if anybody knows her. And she says, almost everything will work again if you unplug it for a few minutes, including you. Unplugging is spiritual practice. It's going into the silence so that another current expression that's come about is doom scrolling. Doom scrolling is getting on the media. What's the newest post about this, about that, about them, about ooh, you name it. And that's what we become addicted to. I want to see who's fighting with who, and I want to see where I can rub my hands and get into the fight. And yet the very call is unplug, take a deep breath, turn it all off, and go inside and see the fury with which your own mind operates and bring it to a quiet place. You live there. It's your under your control. What are you going to do about it?
You know, it's really interesting because that we go back to that courage of the heart again. And during this volatile time, I think I've had friends that I wanted to unfriend, literally, physically, and on Facebook. And I had to go deep and say, okay, I need to find that point in me that loves them unconditionally, which I have most of my life until this subject came up. And I want to address something else here. That it is interesting. Right now, our children, we program our children. We are, they come out, they listen to us, and we can absolutely show them all of the diversity and all the inclusion where we don't see color anymore, that, you know, there is no they're good, they're bad, they're whatever, including religion and health, and the willingness to be open and receptive, whatever it is. What is really interesting is our children now are being programmed to be afraid of everything because of COVID. There is no color. There is no color here. It's anybody who's a stranger may have COVID, and we want them to stand away from them and stand back from them. And I thought, what is this doing, this COVID generation, to just humanity? And going into that courageous heart place and reassuring not only ourselves, but those who are being programmed by us to not be afraid of everything. That is the greater challenge I have too right now. The inclusiveness, I'm sure that I have programming there somewhere. I don't feel it though. I've always been very embracing of everything and everyone that I can remember. But, you know, who knows, if you challenge me enough, I'm sure I'll come out with some prejudice that I have. I want to throw that in your lap. What do we do for our young people now who are being raised to be afraid of everything?
You know, the lesson is the same as I've shared somewhat. Most of my family go their own way in their spiritual pursuits. And a lot of it is pursuing, not yet finding that certain something. But with a couple of my grown grandchildren, is the first time that I'm starting to be able to communicate. And yet everything we do has a profound impact on our kids. It's not just sitting down and teaching a lesson. It's the observations that kids are so astute at making as they watch their parents and watch the interaction and listen to the conversations. That in itself is a lesson in either racial justice or injustice or judgment about sexual preferences. So it comes through, and the only thing we can do for ourselves is to awaken, because everything we're looking at still has to be taken as a personal responsibility. I have contributed, we've all contributed to exactly the situation that we're conditionally all experiencing. And as everything that does happen, for every effect there's a cause, and for every cause there's an effect. The cause is invisible. It's in our mental states, our perceptions, our beliefs, the conditioning we've been exposed to. To completely override that is to really learn the lesson broadly of metaphysics and the lesson specifically of the science of mind. It's conscious mind has control over subconscious mind. And principle, the overall principle of oneness, of inclusiveness, of unity, harmony, compassion, wisdom, is the undergirding and overshadowing way that life works. And yet if I'm not consciously aware of that, my kids know it. The people I visit with, the markets I go to, everybody, if I don't say it, and particularly now our faces, ideally, are hidden, but our eyes are still conveying, they're the windows of the soul, either my resistance, my coldness, my withdrawal, or my judgment. It all comes out. And that's another signal, I think, from this grand universal intelligence to stop looking, judging by the appearance. Judge within, righteously, rather than wanting to think you've got the answer or I've got the answer to make things right. Set the self in right relationship with the divine. Take silence, take solitude, take everyone around you as a teacher and a student, because that's what we're here to do. We're not threatened by a virus. We're threatened by the fear that it has instilled with all of us. And from that fear, which can easily turn to anger at the thought of being fearful, we're people intellectually who are used to being in control. That fear can become dangerous. Therefore, frightened people do have the potential for becoming dangerous people. And we're seeing it. It's evidenced on the streets of just about every city in our nation and throughout the world. So how do you teach your children? By being that awareness, that constant replication of a sense of unity with the divine, that as good as it gets or as bad as it gets, it's all under the auspices of infinite intelligence and unconditional love. Is that a hard one to swallow, particularly in today's environment? Of course. Does that mean that we should step back from it or away from it? No. That's the challenge. And really, that is the accusation that that's the question I've got to ask. Am I doing enough? Am I being enough aware of my oneness with God to truly make a profound difference with the children, with the adults, with my family, with those that I just superficially nod to in passing? That's the challenge.
You know, it is. And in that divinity, when we speak our truth, many of us that are facing these fears and these challenges, including me, you have to say, how am I telling my truth from that highest place? And do I really know my truth? You've got to find out who you are, literally, and before you can even come from that truth of divinity. And then I have that simple equation that I use, and that simple equation is no matter what I am listening to, what I am hearing in conversation with, not to go straight to judgment and fear and lash out, but it is to go to what I want this world to look like and be like, that inclusive, honoring all of the religions, all of the faiths, all of the beingness, and giving each their turn to speak their truth in safe, loving places. It doesn't mean I have to be that person. I have to, you, as you said, be that image. I want to tell you something about, this is just, I'm going digressing a little bit, but this is, I just remembered this story is, given who I am, my granddaughter, who's now 4, we've talked about past lives before. And she said to me, a couple of times, well, who was mommy before she was my mommy? And I said, well, she was a little baby inside. And I think we chose to be together or something. So she takes my daughter, Katie, she says, let's play past lives. And she says, okay, mommy, now I'm going to be your mommy and you're going to be my baby. So put your head in the basket because you're dead. The clothes basket. So I can give birth to you. And I thought, you don't know how powerful you are and their perception of everything, you know. But I love that. Okay, so you can be born to me and I'll be your mommy now. Put your head in the clothes basket. That's it. I just remember that. And you don't even realize what they're taking in. And well, so you have to be conscious. Yeah.
Out of the mouths of babes. Yes. And that's why even the teachings of the Christ are involved. Let the little children come, because out of that still purity, out of the lessened conditioning to the influence of others and personally and of the world, comes the knowingness of who really they are. As the time marches on and our experience becomes more of our teacher outwardly than our inner experience, we forget. We go into that amnesia state. And that's why soul remembrance in the silence, in the spiritual practices, is the salvation. We're not going to solve physical conditions with other physical conditions. Gandhi said it. You need soul power to alter physical circumstances. Yes. So however you name it, whether it's the Buddhist tradition or the Hebrew, the Christian, or the religious science, it's still a matter of seek ye first the inner awareness of oneness with God. That is the conscious control you have over your subconscious mind that alters what seems to be a very solid fact will dissolve under the influence of an abstract creative idea that is transcendent to the fact. So it's an inside job. And until we come more collectively. I'm thinking to myself this morning as we gather first early and we pray each other in, and I'm thinking how this is going on, not just in Pleasant Valley, but it, whether it's in the ashram or whether yesterday or tomorrow it's in the temple or in private homes going into meditation, how much of this is gathering momentum. And that's what we need to look at, to know that if good is being honored and celebrated individually and collectively, ultimately and inevitably, according to spiritual law, that good emerges. So that's the call of the day, the moment, the hour, is bring forth that spirit within people, rise and shine. This is your time. This is it right here and right now.
I agree 100%. And I am so grateful that you're with us today. And I just say, keep holding the high watch for self and all. And that I always say, we are just energy beings. We are. Yes. So the more you open up to that wonderful divinity, that spirit within, that's what goes and flows ever outward. And you need to shine your light. Without your light, the world is a little darker. So please keep that light going. Go to the highest place, just pour love on everything and see that inclusiveness with the everything, which is the allness, which is the nothingness that truly is the deepest part of our soul. And so, Dr. Sue, thank you so much. I love your words and your conversations, and I love you. That's all I have
right
to
back
say.
At you. Four words to take away, people. God is I am. Acknowledging a higher power of your own understanding and placing yourself consciously in union with it. God is I am. All are. Everything is. And so it is.
And those words uplift me. And speaking of uplifting, Danny, we introduce Daniel Berkman again. I will be very formal. Danny, are you there?
I'm here.
Yay. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sue and Pamella, for your inspiring words.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I can't think of a better way to express the oneness of God than to play a little music. So what I'm going to do now is improvise, which is what I normally do. So this is a little improvisation for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You're my spiritual source. That just vibrates. I mean, that spirit within you just vibrates all throughout me. Thank you, Daniel, so
you're
much.
Welcome.
And we'll
thank
see you
Pam.
Soon. We'll see you very, very soon. Blessings galore on me.
I look forward to it. Thank you.
Yeah. And looking and knowing that music and that vibration goes across the planet, because we could use all of a little bit of Daniel Berkman, a lot of Daniel Berkman every day.
Okay. I appreciate that.
Anyway, so now we go to our offertory, and if you would like to do this silently or out loud, we're going to say, Divine love blesses
and multiplies
all that I have, all that I give, all that I receive, and so it is. And that's the way it is. Yay! And here's another way. We we are so appreciative of your donations. They mean a lot. They keep our center alive. And especially during these changing times, we have had talks about giving up the building, and it always comes back to knowing that Divine Source is supporting where we will be meeting once we can all be together again. So, thank you for watching our Sunday service. And if you do feel like you receive value from this experience, please support our ministry with your tax-deductible donation. Visit our website at www.csl.pleasantvalley.org. We accept PayPal and Zelle. And just blessings for all that are with us today. And if you would like to do conversation afterwards, we invite you. We're going to play one more song after I give you this message. If we want to have conversation afterwards, please, as your Zoom ID put in 805-987-5379, and then your Zoom password, which is capital L, capital D, 2, lowercase m, lowercase h, lowercase r. And we're just going to close with Master Shaw's song, Love, Peace, and Harmony, that already has, it also holds a vibrational consciousness, and we want that to go out across the world. So thank you, and once done, please join us on Zoom.
I love my heart and soul. I love all humanity. Join hearts and souls together. Love, peace, and harmony.
Thank you so much for being with us. Blessings galore. I love each and every one of you. Now you can go on Zoom and be with us. Thank you, Spencer. Everybody wave goodbye. Betty Ann, Dr. Sue, Danny, Spencer, and and goodbye. And Lenny and Buzzy, and also behind the scenes, our Spencer who waved at us. Thank you. And our wonderful Marcia Beebe. And I hope to see you in any moment now on Zoom. Mwah! See ya.